I have peace and joy and blessing in the service of the King. That's great. 437, 437. Since the Savior found me, pardon all my sin. Let's all stand together as we sing. Since the Savior found me, pardon all my sin. I have had the joy and living hope within. Gone is all the shame and sorrow of the past. There underneath the precious blood of Christ at last. Save, 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 I'm happy on the way. Save, 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 I love him more each day. Save, 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 I know his mighty charm. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power. Since the Savior found me, all to him I know. For his precious blood has washed me white as snow. Now no condemnation, happy as can be. I'm glad that Jesus justifies and sets me free. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy all the way. Saved, 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 I love him for his name. Saved, 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 I know his mighty star. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his Savior found me, I have perfect rest, living in the realms of joy and happiness, leaning on my Savior, looking for that day when he shall come to catch his waiting bride away. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy all the way. Saved, 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 I love him more each day. Saved, 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 I know his mighty charm. And keeps and sanctifies me by his power. Amen. I hope you can say that tonight. Amen. I love him more each day. That's good. That's good. Let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this evening. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to come back again together and hear your word preached. Lord, sing songs to you, give to you. Lord, I just thank you for allowing us to worship you today. God, I pray that you would take control of this service. I pray that you would be honored. You would be blessed. Lord, I pray that you would look good. In Jesus' precious and holy name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let's go to 341, 3-4. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. 3-4-1. 3-4-1. On that first, I heard an old, old story. How a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory! Savior forever, he sought me and he bought me soul with his redeeming blood. Praise God, he loved me and I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about again, and he caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me soul with his redeeming blood. Praise God, he loved me ere I knew him, and all my love
Well, as you've been able to tell already, probably, Pastor is gone, and he's on a much deserved vacation, and I look forward to having him back next Sunday. This Wednesday, we will have Brother Moreland will be here. He'll give us an update on his trip and be preaching for us. Look forward to that. Things coming up next Sunday as well. We'll have our higher ground offering. Pray that you will be praying about what the Lord would have you to give towards the carpeting and the lighting and for both in here and the fellowship hall, transitioning that over to LED and just trying to be good stewards of what God's given us here. And so that's what the higher ground offering is for next Sunday. The 13th is the men's barbecue, and I should have a sign-up sheet for that out there, but I do not yet. I'll throw one out there real quick for after this evening service. You can sign up, begin signing up for that. And put on your calendars, 15th, 16th, and 17th. A little different, but try to be here on that Monday and Tuesday night. You won't regret it. We'll be putting together John and Romans, and we'll be putting together the John and Romans that we'll be passing out at the Arts in the Alley Parade on September 17th, I believe it is, Saturday, the last day of the Missions Conference. And it was a great time last year. We have a float that we'll have in the parade, and then everybody will be either on the float or walking with a float and passing out the John and Romans from the church. It has it's a personalized cover, and on the inside it has kind of a advertisement for the Words to Encourage radio broadcast and RU and different things. It's just really, it's a nice John and Romans there. And then also, if you would, August 26th, next month, the end of the month is our 5 years anniversary of RU here at Bible Baptist Church. It's amazing that we've been doing this for 5 years. But we're going to be celebrating our five-year anniversary with an open house. Maybe you might wonder what RU's all about, and maybe you don't want to have the commitment of coming every week, or just not sure about it, but this would be a good time to check us out, all right? We'll be having an open house that day, have a time of fellowship afterwards, and we have a special guest speaker coming from the state up north, and he'll be coming, though, and he's a great... great RU director up in Michigan, and he's Bridgeport, and you'll really, really, really enjoy him. Just an awesome guy. But if you would, plan on that. We'd love to have you, and looking forward to celebrating 5 years of RU here at Bible Baptist Church. And so we'll probably tell the story of how we got started, and it's just really exciting to see how God just put all that together. And any other, I don't think we have anything else as far as announcements go. And I'm looking, and do we have any first-time guests? Have you been here before? You've been here before. Yeah, okay. Great, good to see you again. And I don't think we have any other first-time guests. All right, this time, let's hear from the choir. Thank you. 11 in your hymnal, number 11. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is my number 11. We'll sing both stanzas.
Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged the sinner for a sinless one.
Bye.
298. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. 298. When you find that, if you'd stand with me. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. From him no power of evil can sever. He gave his life to ransom my soul. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Once I was lost in sin's degradation, Jesus came down to bring me salvation, lifted me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Sing that chorus together. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. Let's sing that last together. Joy flood my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. His precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I belong to him. Now I belong. seated. Some men come to prepare for their offering this evening. Again, if you want to note a special gift to Brother Mann, he'd appreciate it. We'd appreciate it. And it's been a blessing to us today. And appreciate him coming out and giving his day to us and ministering to us. Brother Linderman, would you ask the Lord to bless the offering, please?
Let's pray. Father, again, we just want to come to you, Lord, and just thank you for loving us the way you do, taking care of us and meeting our needs, Lord. And that's just an amazing song that we sing, Father, that will be with you for eternity. It's just an amazing thought, eternity. We just want to thank you for that, Lord. And we owe it all to Jesus Christ for giving his life for us. We just want to thank you. I just pray, Lord, that you'll speak to our hearts tonight as we hear the message, Lord. Help us to be a little bit more like your son. Yes. And we'll give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is my story. To God be the glory. I'm only a sinner saved by grace. Well, we're going to have Brother Mann come again this evening. Before he comes, Tanya's going to come and sing a special. And as soon as she is finished, you come right on ahead.
Mankind was lost, and then Jesus came. salvation, thy great salvation, so rich and free.
All right, thank you, ladies, very, very much. I appreciate the pianists and organists, all the work that they put into it, all the different specials, all the different, you know, I mean, I have gone to churches, I've been to churches that don't have a pianist or organist, and it's tough. It's tough without a piano player. I'm so thankful that the church I started, my aunt agreed to come and play on that first service. Well, she didn't come for, let's see, no, she didn't come for Sunday school, the first, but she did come for our first service. And she played, you know, and she's, you know, does very well also. And but she played that morning. Well, that's all she was planning on playing, was just that Sunday morning kind of helped me out. So I already had some songs picked out, you know, because I have a 12-string acoustic Gibson guitar. So I was going to strum, you know, and play the guitar while everybody sang and lead the singing at the same time. Well, evidently, she liked something about that service that morning, and she came up to me after the service, I think it was, and she said, "Well, do you have songs picked out for tonight?" I said, "Yeah, I've got them picked out." She said, "Well, what are they? You want me to play them?" And I said, "Well, yeah, okay." So she came back Sunday night. Well, then after the service, we went over to my mom and dad's house, and we were sitting on the front, you know, stoop out there, the front little front porch. My wife and I, my mom and dad, and my aunt. So there's five of us sitting out there, and we're talking, you know. And I'm going to have a Thursday night service because I couldn't rent the building on Wednesday night, but they'd let me have it on Thursday, so I'm going to have Thursday night service. And we're talking and everything, and I'm, you know, totally planning on getting my guitar out and strumming the guitar and playing the songs and all that. And she looked at me again. She said, "Well, do you have songs picked out for Thursday?" I said, "Yeah, I do. I'm ready." She said, "Well, do you want me to play?" I said, "Well, yeah." And, you know, I mean, that was 1982, and she still goes to church there. You know, she wasn't planning on it. She was going to the local Methodist church down the road. And she got saved when she was a kid and everything. And she told me about when she got saved and all that. But she was going to the United Methodist church down the road. And she came to me one day and she said, "Well," of course she called me Gary because she's my aunt. Well, she said, "Well, Gary," she said, "I've got a question to ask you." I said, "Okay, what's that?" She said, "Well, I made a promise to the United Methodist Church that I would give them $100 for a particular project." She said, "What do you think I should do?" I said, "I think you need to keep your promise." She said, "Really?" I said, "Well, yes, you made a promise to them that you was going to pay them $100 for a certain project. I want you to keep your promise." She was attending my church. But I said, you pay that promise that you made. You keep your promise." You know, and she continued to come. Now, speaking of keeping your promises and what have you, you know, you will be so glad when you get the new carpet. You know, I saw your pastor's office. It's pretty wore out in there and needs some new carpet. And new carpet in here and what have you. But you will be especially excited about the LED lighting. You really, really will. It is so worth the investment. Now, I don't know, but there are certain programs in certain states where if you get in touch with the electric company and say, "We're going to invest in LED lighting," sometimes they will match that or whatever, or even reimburse you. So I don't know if you've looked into that. I don't know if they do that. You've looked into it. It brightens it up so much. And we did that recently at our auditorium down at Longview. And that auditorium seats around 950 people, something like that. It's a large auditorium. And it made a huge difference in the lighting, okay? You're going to notice the difference. It's going to be so much brighter. My eyes and my ears are older than the rest of me. And so I do. I supposed to wear glasses, but I don't have any. I'm a tightwad. And they wanted me to start using trifocals, and I said, no. That's for old people. But anyway, and so I'm supposed to use that. But, you know, the lighting in our auditorium was regular incandescent bulbs, and it was kind of dark. And when we went to the LED lighting, boom. I mean, it's bright, you know, they have a lot less shadows, and it uses a lot less electricity, a huge amount of less electricity. And so it is very, very worth it. You say, but $10,000. Oh, man, that's a drop in a bucket compared to what we used to have to raise it down there. We would have give-it-alls 2 times a year for $100,000 each. Sometimes they were $300,000 each. And man, I mean, if he didn't have enough pledges for whatever amount it was, he'd say, okay, we're not leaving this room until we get enough pledges. So everybody just kind of started sinking. But anyway, it's just, you know, what's very, very exciting about it is making progress, okay? You should always have something going on and making progress. Okay, and love your facilities, the way you've changed things. The last time I was here, I think it was the last time, the office was right back there. So that tells you how long it's been since I've been here. And but I love the new office facility. She said that it used to be for some part of the nursery workers or something. What's that? Toddlers and the babies. And I said, well, you picked the right place for Brother Slayball. Don't tell him I said that. He's watching. Hi, Dad. Okay, I figured he was. But anyway, yeah, he's probably. Where did he go on vacation? Does anybody know? Now y'all are saying it's, he went where? New Jersey. He's in New Jersey drinking a cup of coffee. Is that what he's doing right now? And he's telling you that he's in church tonight, but he's probably got his Bermuda shorts on out playing shuffleboard somewhere. Just kidding. He's got the shorts, but not playing shuffleboard. But anyway. Yeah. It's going to be a few years until I come back again. So it's been good to see you. But anyway. Yeah. Well, they used to say stuff like that about me when I was pastoring. So this is just payback time, all that kind of thing. But anyway, we're just thankful for his health and for the church. I this is a good crowd of people for a Sunday night. He had a great crowd this morning, and I like what I'm seeing here. Okay, I really, really do. A lot of churches are really, really, really struggling. I preach in a church. Out in another state, I won't say where, and Casey gets this. But anyway, I preach in a church in another state out west, and if he can get 10 people to come together, he's lucky. And he has to work a job on the side and all this kind of thing, take care of his family and what have you. But we're going to see what we can do about helping him, because part of what I want to do is not only help new churches that are to get started, but I also want to help struggling churches. I pastored for 13 years. I started a church from scratch. I had nothing. Okay? I had nothing. I didn't have songbooks. I didn't have office machinery. The only office machine, back up, I had one piece of office machinery. It was a portable typewriter that my mom and dad gave to my sister for Christmas in 1965. And this is 1982. Yeah, I believe it too. I'm telling you the truth now. And but that's what I used. That's what I had. That's what I typed out everything on. Didn't have computers then. I mean, it was starting to come out, what have you, personal computers, but I didn't have one. We went to Ohio, and I had about $230 to my name. I didn't have any bills. I didn't owe anything anywhere, but I only had $230 to my name. We found, my mom and dad found a house for us to rent, And the first month's rent, after graduation from college, first month's rent was paid by my grandparents as a graduation present. It was $300 a month. They paid my first rent. My second month's rent, my mom and dad paid for. The third month's rent on the church that I started paid for. And I mean, I started that church 1 month after I graduated from college. And I had to hit the ground running because I was hungry. And I had two girls and a wife to feed, and they eat a lot of hay. So anyway, I started the church, and I started eating. They started, as soon as I could, they started paying me on a weekly basis. And they paid me $50 a week. That was it. I didn't have any credit cards, didn't have any credit card bills. Wish I didn't now. But that's how we started. To sing, I would choose the songs, and then I would do something that is illegal to do, but nobody knows about it because they didn't know then. I would make copies out of a songbook, and I would set those copies out on the chairs, and I kept those copies. Well, one time, we're singing, I'm leading the singing, you know, the pianist is playing, and all of a sudden, everybody in the room stops singing, except me and the piano player. I had the book, she had the book, they had the paper, I forgot the copy, page 2. And so they only had half the song. But anyway, the room that we used, they're in a small, Ostrander, Ohio is a village of about 400 people back then. They may have 401 now, they may have grown since then. But I put up 30 chairs. You know, that was pretty big for us, 30 chairs. And the rent for that was $150 a month. And I told the lady that I said, how much do you want for me to use that room? She said the people want $150 a month. I said, okay, I'll agree to that, under one stipulation. She says, what's that? I said, I don't have any money right now, but in 2 weeks I'll give you $75. Half of it. 2 weeks later, I'll give you the other $75. And as soon as we can, I'll start paying you $150 up front. And she said, okay. So that's what we did. And we paid that bill and all that kind of thing. Anyway, long story short, winter came along, and all of a sudden, we showed up for church that one Sunday morning, and that big building that we were meeting in didn't have any heat, and it was winter time. I mean, it was cold outside. It was so cold outside that there was one bathroom, and it was in the middle of the building, and the water in the commode was frozen. Wow. That's how cold it was in that building. We still had a church service that morning, but it was abbreviated. It was a short one. It was a quicken. The only thing I was really interested in was getting that offering. Because we had to pay for that room, you know. I started in June 27th, 1982. By the first Easter, we were running 75. So things kind of held there for about 7 years until we got our own property. We built on our property. Somebody in the church loaned us $100,000 to build. And just on and on and on. But I know what it's like to start a church. I've been there and done that, okay? And so my wife and I, we helped our two son-in-laws who started churches a year and a half ago, one in Washington and one in Idaho. We went there for 2 weeks each and helped them, passing out materials, John and Romans, and just everything. You know, we'd go out, just hang things on doorknobs and knock on people's, you know. And there are still people to this day that come because of that come and visit. They had a visitor about 3 months ago that came because of the stuff we passed out a year and a half ago. It's not a waste of money. It's not a waste of time. Okay, so get involved in that John and Romans thing. But we helped them. We know what it's like. And that's what we want to do, but we also want to help struggling small churches that are really, really struggling. I think what I can do is help by getting other churches in the area that are already well established to help for about a month. okay, maybe one group per week or whatever, and help the new church get information out and all that kind of thing. So you pray about it. I'd love to come back in September for your missions conference so I can get your support. But I'm only praying for 20 churches. $50 per church. That's all I'm praying for. 20 churches, $50 per church. That's $1,000. Like I said this morning, we're already paying for the truck, we're already paying for the insurance, we're already making the payments on the trailer. By the way, the air conditioner started working just a little while ago. It's like some people that work for a while and won't work for a while. They work for a while and won't work for a while. You know? And I don't look at him when I said, but anyway. Do you need some counseling tonight? I mean, I'm about, just kidding. And I love to pick on people. Anyway, because I'm leaving in the morning. But you know, there's ways we can help churches, and because of our experience and my wife knowing what a pastor's wife deals with and all that kind of thing, I think we can be a help to some people. And we know America needs some help right now, and I think the way to help our country the best is by making sure our churches get started and they're strong and all that. Okay, well, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, please. 1 Corinthians 15. But hopefully I can add this church to the list that supports me. And when churches support me, I send letters to them, tell them what's happening. And I don't just send letters saying, you know, pray for my wife, she's sick, that kind of stuff. Though if she ever does get sick, I'll tell you. But we tell how many people we've had saved in the month and that kind of thing, because I want people to know that we are soul winners, we win people to Christ, we work at it hard. And even today, when I was out to lunch with Bob and Kay, where are you? Oh, there you are. Yeah, you're right over here. I saw this gentleman sitting at another table, and he had a bicycle on his shirt, and it was called the Pan Ohio Ride. And this guy's pretty good size, and so I'm thinking, I don't see him riding all the way across Ohio, but I'm going to ask him. And so as they're getting ready to leave, you know, I said, hey, did you ride in that ride? Oh, no, I was the DJ. I said, oh, great, okay. And so you know, we're talking a little bit, and he said, he said something like, Lord willing, someday I might ride in that ride myself. And I said, I'm glad you brought that up. Are you saved? Have you ever trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? So everywhere we go, we try to do that. We're not always successful. We don't always take advantage of the opportunities like we should. All of us are like that. Okay, I mean, I've been soul winning since 1975. Folks, that's a long time. That's 41 years, basically. And so, my family, the best year that my family ever had was, and my three daughters, my wife, and myself, the best year that we ever had, we had over 800 people saved and 80 people baptized. Now, that doesn't happen that way all the time. The next year, it was like Titanic, you know, wah. And but we work at it. I've got couples right now, adult couples, that my wife and I are helping, we're discipling, encouraging, and what have you, to keep them in church, get them in church. We invite them over to our house for supper. And, you know, I'm really kind of a quiet individual when I'm at home, so I don't say much because I'm talking all the time out here. And but we get there and had that couple come over. And after they left, they told somebody, they said, that was the most fun time that we have ever had, was going to their house. And I thought, okay, I guess so. And it's just like a friend of mine. There's a book that I don't have back there. I sold my last one 2 days ago. It's a book called Job's Wife, and it's written especially for ladies, and won't go through the background of it and everything. And but a pastor bought that book in Center, Texas, a month or two ago, and he told somebody, he said, that's the best book I have ever read. And I thought to myself, well, he must only read comic books then. He didn't say that about my book. He said that about her book. But anyway, I was just kind of teasing. But anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're going to look at the whole chapter here, and we're going to be quick tonight because I've already made quite a few comments and I see what time it is, but we'll be done here before the night's over with, okay? And 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm going to read just a few verses, and I'll have you stand as we read the verses out of respect to God's word. I did not do that this morning, but we'll do it tonight, and because I see a couple of you drifting off already, but I want you to listen carefully now, okay? So we're just going to read the first four verses together, and either in your Bible or on your cell phone or wherever. And it's still the Word of God, brother, you know. So anyway, it says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." And we'll stop there, kind of in the middle of the sentence, but we'll finish it here in a little bit. Now, Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for these good people, for the pastor. Like I said this morning, pray that you just give him a refreshing time and out there in New Jersey, and just ask, Father, that you give them home safely, and thank you for what you're doing in this church here in Grove City, and for all that you've done for us, and just thank you. But I do pray, Father, that we will not be selfish Christians. I pray that we'll take the message that you've left us and do what we're supposed to do with it, and I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. And but in Revelation chapter 20, I want you to put a piece of paper or your ribbon there at 1 Corinthians 15, because we're going to come back to that. But now I want you to go to Revelation chapter number 20. And we're going to read a bunch of verses tonight. And as soon as I can find, remember where I put my spectaculars, my glasses. And we'll get into this thing tonight. But in Revelation chapter number 20, okay, stop and think about this with me for a second. The Bible says that the preaching of the cross is to them that what? Perish. What is it to them? It's foolishness. Why is it foolishness? Well, because we talk about somebody who came back alive from the dead. Foolish. Are you kidding me? I think that's one reason why they say that it's foolish. Because we talk about somebody who came back from the dead. You know, they're used to watching, you know, The Walking Dead, which is a fictional kind of thing and satanic to say at the least, and all that kind of stuff. And so to them it's a fairy tale world. To them it's not real. Now to people in Haiti, zombies are real. I've been to Haiti, and there was a witch doctor there. We were going gate knocking, because you can't get to their door. You have to knock on their gate, okay? Because every house, just about not every house, but many of the houses, it's a compound. They have a tall wall around it. There's a gate there, a steel gate or a bar gate or whatever. And what you do is you pick up a rock. And you hit the steel gate, or you hit the bars on the gate. That gets their attention. They don't have doorbells. You know, they're lucky if they have electricity. And the house that we stayed in while we were there for that week, my wife and I, was the missionary's house, and we were helping him start a church in Haiti. And so we went there for the week and helped him. And I did everything from carrying benches down the hill. I, you know, helped run the electricity. I helped clear out the thing. And one night during the service, it was raining pretty good, and you just preach anyway. I mean, you tie up a tarp and tie it to the different palm trees, and you just get out there and preach, you know. And it's kind of rainy and everything, and I'm standing kind of on the edge of the awning and preaching, and gave the invitation, and this lady, I'll never forget the sight, Brother Bob. She got up out of her seat, a Haitian lady. And she went over to this wall. We had moved a bunch of rocks, cleared it out, and moved those rocks and piled them up over here next to this wall. This lady, in the rain, got down on her knees in that pile of rocks and stayed there for about 15, 20 minutes, praying, weeping. I mean, it was an amazing thing. And but Haiti, boy, it's a rough country. It is a, you know, your cruises don't stop at Port-au-Prince. They don't stop there. They go on to the same island, but on the other side of the island, they go to the Dominican Republic. And I was preaching one time in Boston after I went to was it Boston? Yeah, it was Boston. And preaching there for a couple days for a friend of mine, and he has a Haitian service after the main service. And so there's some Haitian people coming in, and this is after I went to Haiti. And here I am, completely white guy, and here they are, you know, Haitian folks coming in. And I looked at them, and I said, "Comment ye?" You know, they looked at me, said, and they started talking in Creole, and I said, "Whoa, whoa, 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 that's all I know." It's like me with Spanish. I know a little bit of Spanish. Enchiladas, burritos, tacos. I know a little bit of Spanish. No, I do know a little bit of Spanish. You know, gringo es muy loco en la cabeza. Now, I don't know if you know what that means, but it means I'm crazy in the head. I'll tell you what it means. I know a little French. Frère Jacques, dormez-vous, sonne le matina, ding, dang, dong, ding, dang, dong. It was my third or fourth grade teacher, I can't remember, and I was in love with my teacher. She was very, very young, and you're talking about the red lipstick. She had the red lipstick. She had just graduated from college. That's how young she was. This was her first class, and oh, I'm in love with my teacher. I can remember what she looks like to this day. The black hair, I mean, she was pale, pale. I mean, she was white, white. I don't know if it was the makeup or she never got out in the sun, but she was white, brother. The red lipstick. And so she taught us this little expression, Jason. She taught us this little expression in French. It was fermer la grande bouche. Now, you say, what does that mean? Well, I'll explain it, okay? But I always wanted my teacher to say that to me. You got to watch. Because when she said it, she would say, ferme la grande bouche. Okay? I'll get back to the message in a minute. Somehow I'll weave this in there. I was in love with my teacher, brother. I was in love. And when she said bouche, you know what I'm thinking. Yeah. He winks and, yeah, buddy, I know what you're thinking. Yeah, I wanted to kiss my teacher. Oh, please forgive me. I was just a kid. I wasn't saved. I wasn't going to church. I didn't know any better. I was just being a typical boy in love with a pretty teacher. Okay. So I'd have her say that to me often. So she would say, ferme la grande bouche. Now, what does it mean? I would talk on purpose in class so she would say that to me. And what it means is, shut your big mouth. But I was in love with my teacher. Now, I have no idea where I was going with that. The Haitian woman, yeah. I talked about her. Never mind. I'll get back to I'm going to stick with my notes. Point number one. In Revelation chapter 20, I really forget where I was going. I'll think of it later. Revelation chapter 20, verse 1, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that is going to happen. One of these days, there's going to be an angel come down from heaven. He's going to have a key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. It's going to happen. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. That is going to happen. It hasn't happened yet, but it is going to happen. Just as sure as you're sitting here tonight, that is going to happen. Verse 3. So he binds him for 1,000 years, and he casts him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. We were talking about hell. He's asking questions about hell back in the back. What's it like? What's it, you know, and all that kind of thing. Well, think about a bottomless pit. And I'm not talking about somebody who eats a lot, okay? A bottomless pit. Some people do say that hell is in the center of the earth. I'm not sure because I've never been there, okay? And because I'm saved, I never will go there. And I'm glad for that. Bottomless pit. Bottomless pit. If it is in the center of the earth, then here's what happens. The Bible talks about a person in hell that falls and falls and falls and falls and falls for eternity because they're in the bottomless pit. If it is in the center of the earth, then here's what happens. When you're in the center of the earth, and if it's round, and you start at the very extreme part of it, doesn't matter where, you're going to fall towards the center of the earth because of gravity. Are you with me? Once you pass the center of the earth, you start slowing down. And then eventually you stop, and then you start falling the other way again because gravity on the other side of the earth pulls you gravity pulls us towards the center of the earth. Are you with me? Regardless of where you are, I've been on India, and my feet were pointing probably towards the United States somewhere, and somebody in the United States, they were upside down from me. So we're drawn to the center of the earth. So somebody in the bottomless pit, if this is where it is, they fall and fall, they pass the center, they slow down, they start falling the other way. And then they fall and fall and fall. And while they're falling, other people are falling too. Somebody's falling this way and somebody else is falling this way. And somebody else is falling this way and somebody else is falling this way. And you're bumping, crashing into each other, and there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. He's going to be thrown in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. I like it where it says they shut him up. Now, it doesn't mean what you said to your wife recently that really doesn't work. Shut up. That's not what I'm saying. It means he's locked up. He's in the bottomless pit. He's chained up. He can't get out. Can't get away from it for 1,000 years. Now, watch this. This is going to happen. I'm glad this is going to happen. Verse 4, and I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. So while Satan is bound up in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years, those people that had their heads cut off, they were persecuted because of the word of God and what have you, they are going to rule and reign. We are going to be there also. We are going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ for the millennial reign. We call it the millennial reign of Christ for that 1,000-year period of time. Are you with me? That's going to happen. That's going to happen. When somebody dies and they're a Christian, that's just the beginning. That's just the beginning. Those 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years that person lives, that's just the beginning. There is eternity. Somebody mentioned eternity in their prayer a little while ago. Eternity, that we cannot imagine that. But we are going to rule and reign there with Christ for 1,000 years, and then God the Father is going to come down later on, and then we're going to rule, and we're going to be under His leadership and all that for all eternity. When you get saved, you are given the gift of eternal life. How long is eternal? I asked somebody in New Jersey that question as I was witnessing to him. I said, how long is eternal? He said, well, it's longer than forever. People in New Jersey are kind of smart. You wouldn't think so because they got Christie for governor. But anyway, oh, where did that come from? He's Republican. Don't you know better? Well, okay. All right. Two things I don't talk about is politics and religion. But anyway, so how long is eternal? It says it's forever. If you are given the gift of eternal life, then it lasts forever. Can you ever lose something that is forever? No. If you can't lose something that's forever, then do you ever have to ask for it again? No. But I go back to the question this morning from the book of Romans, what? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What's the answer? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Just because we're saved does not give us a blank check to go out and do whatever we want to do. All right? And I already covered that this morning. Now I'm in this part. I got to stick with my notes, or I'll chase some rabbits and forget where I was going. Satan is going to be bound for 1,000 years in those verses. During that, the tribulation period, or before that, the tribulation period will happen, and those that will be will live, that make it through there or beheaded or whatever, and those of us that are raptured and all that, will live with Jesus Christ for 1,000 years during millennial reign here on the earth. And then look at verses 4 and verse number 6, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years, but the rest of the dead live not again till the 1,000 years are finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power, that they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Hey, there is going to be a rapture takes place someday soon. I don't know when, but I think it's going to be pretty soon. With the condition of the world today, and I know people have been saying that for hundreds of years. I understand that. But you look at the condition of the world today, it's got to be close. With this transgender garbage that has come up, I'm concerned for my grandkids. Because they are going to grow up in a society that says, that's okay. I identify every day as a man. I'm a man, not just because of my last name either. But because it is my last name, I've had to prove it a couple times when I was a kid. But you listen to me. The world has just gone bonkers. Right is wrong and wrong is right. It's okay to pray to Allah wherever you want to pray to Allah. But don't dare pray in the name of Jesus Christ anywhere. It really disappointed me at the Republican National Convention, they had a Muslim pray. I'm with Trump on that one. Keep them out till we find out who they are. And if they want to come to our country, they need to do it the legal way. Not just be shipped in by some bunch of Democrats or politicians that want to ship them in and give them our money. All you have to do is look at France and Germany. See the mess that they're in, and Switzerland and the Netherlands and all the rest because of the influx of people. And they're right. That's not immigration. That's an invasion. All right. Has nothing to do with them. I'm chasing rabbits again. All these things, though, the Bible talks about in the book of Revelation is going to happen. How do I know that? How do I know that's going to happen? I know it because the Bible says so. And that's a good reason. But there's something more to it that I want you to see tonight. Turn back to Romans chapter number 1. Romans chapter number 1. I was talking with a black Muslim one day in Fort Worth, Texas, of all places. And I was talking with him. I was trying to, show him some things about Jesus Christ and how to get saved and all that. And he said, oh, I'm a black Muslim. I said, oh, okay. Well, that's good to meet you. That's fine. And this is quite a few years ago, before 9/11 and all that. So there was no fear there or intimidation. But I looked at the young man and I said this. I said, okay. I said, you believe then that Jesus and Abraham and Muhammad are great prophets. He said, yeah, that's right. Kind of surprised him. Yeah, how did you know that? Okay. I said, okay. I said, there's a huge, huge, huge difference between Muhammad, Abraham, and Jesus. He said, what's that? I said, well, first of all, when Muhammad died, he was buried, right? He said, yeah. And I said, they don't know where his body is, right? And he said, well, yeah. I said, okay, when Abraham died, or Moses, or whoever, when they died, he was buried, right? I said, Jesus died too. But 3 days later, he came back from the dead. I said, there's a huge difference then between him and Muhammad. Would you say that's true? He said, well, yeah, I guess that's true. I said, yeah, it is true. Big difference. Big, 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 big difference. Amen. And he wouldn't trust Christ. It's just like an atheist one time. I talked to an atheist in Arizona. And I'm with a pastor, this young lady in her early 20s. She said, I'm an atheist. And the pastor didn't know what, kind of caught him off guard. And he kind of looked at me and said, can you talk to her? And I said, yeah. And so I started talking to her. She said, no, I don't believe there's a God. I don't believe there's a heaven. I don't believe there's a hell and all that kind of thing. And I said, okay. I said, let me ask you this question. I said, if there is a heaven, would you like to go there? She looked at me, looked down. She said, well, yeah, if there's a heaven, I would like to go there. And I proceeded to show her how to trust Christ as her personal Savior. And I wish I could say that she did, but she didn't. But she got the seed planted anyways. And she began to doubt a little bit. I was in New Mexico in a high school parking lot. Moms and dads were waiting for their teenagers to come out from high school from school for that day. And I'm talking to people, talking to teenagers, talking to moms and dads. And there's this guy sitting on the car, roof of his car. And he's sitting there, and I went up to him, just started talking to him, you know, just like I did you, you know, early. Sir, hey, man, how you doing? It's good to see you, man. Hey, my name's Gary, man. What's your name? And he, Jason. And so it's the guy sitting on the hood of his car waiting for his teenagers to get out. And I finally got to the question. You know the question. If you die today, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? So I asked Jason, the guy sitting on the roof of his car, or on the hood of his car, I said, do you know you're going to heaven? He said, no, I'm going to go to purgatory. I said, oh, but I can show you how to go to heaven. He said, no, I'm going to go to purgatory. Well, I know what religion he is. You know, he's Catholic. You know. And so he said, no, my church teaches and my pastor taught me that I'm going to go to purgatory. And then after I'm in purgatory and all my sins get burned away or whatever, then I'll get to go to heaven. And so I looked at him and I said, how about this? How about if I can show you from the Bible how you can miss going to purgatory and you can go straight to heaven? Would you be interested in that? You know what he said? No, I'm going to purgatory. I'm sorry, but he's not going to purgatory. Once you die, you either go straight to heaven or you go straight to hell. Based on what you've done with Jesus Christ. Period. Doesn't matter if you're Baptist. Doesn't matter if you're independent Baptist. If you've trusted Jesus Christ, and by the way, I was saved in a Baptist church. It was not an independent fundamental Baptist church. Now I'm an independent fundamental Baptist. If I can find somebody who's closer to what the Bible actually teaches, I would be in that group. But I haven't found that group. Are you with me? So I'm still an independent, fundamental, temperamental Baptist. I have talked with people that started out in another religion. They got saved. And from simply reading their Bible, they ended up becoming a Baptist. Are you with me? But how do I know all those things are going to happen that's written in the book of Revelation? How do I know those things are going to happen in the book of Daniel that it's connected with? How do I know some of those things in Ezekiel and Jeremiah and all? How do I know those things are going to happen? Well, they're written in the Bible, and that's pretty good. That's pretty good right there, because that is the inspired word of God. Amen. And I've got no problem with that, but I can take you a step further. In Romans chapter 1, what I was trying to get at with that young man, it says this, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, verse 1, called to be an apostle, separated into the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets and holy scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, how? By the Resurrection of the dead. Ladies and gentlemen, I know this is God's word, and I know everything that's in there that God says is going to happen is going to happen because we serve a risen Savior. He's risen from the dead, which proves him to be, according to Romans 1:3, it says he is proven. It proves him to be the Son of God. Just like the one man said, if you can prove to me I need to be saved in order to go to heaven, I'll do it. I said, if Jesus told you what to do, would you do it? He said, yeah. I showed him in John chapter 3. You remember, you were here this morning, most of you. I showed him from John chapter 3 what Jesus said about being born again. That guy got born again. How do I know I'm going to heaven? Because the Bible says so, yes. But also because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I told you this morning, when I said turn to the book of Ephesians, you know we'll be landing pretty soon. Same goes with 1 Corinthians 15. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I see what time it is. I've got to hit this thing running. But in 1 Thessalonians 4, you don't need to turn there. You know the verses. We're supposed to comfort one another with these words that, you know, there'll be the sound of the trumpet and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive shall and reign shall be caught up together within the air. I had a dream one time, right after I got saved, I learned about the thing called the rapture. Didn't know about it. I got saved, read about it, heard about it. Wow, that's going to be neat. That's going to be fun. All of a sudden, boom, and I won't have to say, beam me up, Scotty. Okay? Just going to go up. Well, in my dream, brother, we're standing in front of the church. The church is right behind me, the building. Okay? And all the Christians are lined up shoulder to shoulder. Okay? And so Jesus is coming back. I mean, the rapture's taking place. Man, it's happening. Man, this is exciting. This is great. This is wonderful. Man, here we go. We're going to get out of this world. We're going to be with Jesus Christ. And man, we're going to be changed in a moment, twinkling of an eye, and all that stuff. And so, but you didn't go up until he got right over you. And so when he got over you, zoom, there you go. He goes to the next person, zoom, there they go. Next person, zoom, there they go. And it gets getting closer and closer to me. Man, I can't wait. I get in the jumping position. I'm going to help him out, you know. I'm excited. This is going to be so much fun, Jason. Wow, we're going to go flying through the sky. I won't need any kind of wings. I won't need an airplane. I won't need nothing around me. I'm just going to go poof up, and I'm whoa. Imagine my first reaction, whoa. Oh, wow, this is neat. This is fun. Okay. You know, you got those idiots that jump off mountains with those wings on and they go flying 60 miles an hour through the thing. What happens when they run into a cliff? Boom, they're gone. Pancake time. So going up, gets over the person next to me. Pow, up they go. And I thought, well, I didn't think they'd make it. And he got over me, Jason. I'm like, man, it's my turn. I'm next. He got over me. Jason and Jason, right? Yeah. Yeah. Got two of you. Are you guys brothers? But anyway. If they're saved, they are, right? Yeah. So he gets right over me. Nothing happens. Oh! Gets the guy next to me. Pow! Up they go. The lady next to me. Pow! Up they go. It gets down to about five or six people away from me. I start crying. Hey! Oh! Wait a minute, don't you remember I got saved? I trusted you the other day. He got about another two or three guys down the way. He turns to me and grins and says, come on up, I was just teasing. I did, I really dreamed that. I'm telling you the truth, okay? I know God has a sense of humor. You know how I know he has a sense of humor? Just look at our faces, but anyway. He's proclaimed to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, there are three or four sections to that chapter. We're not going to take the time because I've already wasted too much time in other stuff. I was trying to help a couple of you stay awake. And but in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 11, we see the reality of the resurrection. He said in 1 Corinthians 15, he said that he rose again according to the Scriptures. And not only that, but he also said in verse number 5, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remained. They were still alive at the time of this writing, but some had fallen asleep. They'd already died. And so after that, he was seen of James and of the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also as of one born out of due time. That's the apostle Paul writing under inspiration. God saw him on the way to Damascus. And he said, Lord, what would that have me to do and all that? He got saved that day. But he said this, it's a reality. The resurrection of Jesus is a reality. And then, though, we have the reality of the resurrection. Then we have the results. If there is no resurrection, if you look at 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 12, it says, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? And then it gives a list of things that would happen if Jesus is not risen from the dead. For example, in verse number 14, it says, if Jesus is not resurrected from the dead, then my preaching is all in vain, and your faith in him is in vain. Your faith in Jesus would be in vain if he had not risen from the dead. Their faith in Muhammad is totally in vain. Their faith in his written in the Quran is totally in vain. It was not given to Muhammad by Gabriel. It was not. Because if it had been, it would be in total agreement with the Bible. We do not serve the same God. Because if we served the same God, we would have the same plan of salvation. For them to get to heaven and have however many virgins that they want, whether it's 50 or 72, I don't know the number. They say you have to die a martyr's death. Strap some dynamite around your chest, go in among people that you don't like, Americans, Jews, or other Muslims, and blow yourself and them up. Then you get to go to heaven and have that many wives. Folks, having that many wives would not be heaven. That's almost equal to having one husband. But anyway. But our preaching is in vain if there's no resurrection of the dead. Our faith is in vain if there's no resurrection of the dead. We are called false witnesses in verse 15 if there's no resurrection of the dead. You're yet in your sins if there's no resurrection of the dead. And those that have already died are perished, and you'll never see them again if there's no resurrection of the dead. And we are most miserable if there's no resurrection and we have absolutely nothing to look forward to. We were talking about our dogs this morning. Their dog died recently, and I'm sorry about this, but I had to put my dog down recently. Oh, that was hard. We'd had her for 15 years. She's the best dog that has ever lived on the face of the earth. I don't care what your dog is. My dog was the best. I had her on hand signals. I could go like that, and she'd be across the room, and if she sees me, go like that, she'd lay down. She was a black lab. We have a dock. It goes out into the lake that's in our backyard along with some other houses. We have a small 1,400 square foot house. It's not a rich area, but we're just fortunate enough to live in a place where there's a lake. Have a dock that goes off into that lake. I could lay her down on this end of the lake, end of the dock, looking at me. I'd lay her down, and I'd have a stick or a ball in my hand. I'd be flipping it up and down, and she's watching. Man, she's got her back to the water. I'd say, ready. As soon as I said ready, she'd tense up because she knows what's coming next. I'd say, go. And she'd get up and lickety-split turn around and start running down that dock, and she'd be looking up in the air because I'm going to throw that stick or that ball out in the water. And she'd jump and she'd get that, and we'd do that just over and over. And my dog is better than any other dog that's ever lived. But anyway, I had to put her down. That was a hard decision. But she'd had a stroke. Wasn't recovering. 15 years old, partially blind, hardly hear. We put her down. I made the call. Put her down. It was hard. If there's no resurrection of the dead, ladies and gentlemen, then when you die, you're just like a dog that dies. Just go back to the dust, nothing there. I'm so glad there's a resurrection of Jesus Christ, amen. Because one of these days, and it deals with that in the next section, not only are there the reality and the results of the resurrection, but there's also the rewards of the resurrection. And I don't have time to read it all, but he's going to give us a new body. It asks the question, with what body shall we be resurrected? Well, this corruptible is going to put on incorruption. Verse 42, this sown in dishonor, it will be raised in glory. It'll be planted in weakness, it'll be raised in power. It'll be planted a natural body and be raised a spiritual body. This mortal body must put on immortality. And all that is a result, and all that is a reward because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, ain't no grave going to hold my body down. Wish I could sing a song. I don't know all of it. I just know that one part. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. That trumpet's going to sound, and my body is going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and it's going to rise up immortal. It's going to rise up incorruptible. It's going to rise up. No more pain. No more suffering. I'll get all my teeth back. I'll get all my hair back. I'll get my sight back. I won't need these stupid hearing aids that I keep forgetting about when I get in the shower that could ruin them the next time I do it. I won't have to worry about all that. I won't have to take any more vitamins. I won't have to worry about my wife preaching to me all the time about the food that I eat. I won't have to go to the doctors anymore. We won't need any more hospitals. We won't need any more dentists. We won't need any more stinking lawyers. We won't need any of that kind of stuff. Why? Because we're going to be resurrected from the dead, and it's going to be all right. But those that perish say it's foolishness. Well, if you want to believe that you go to nothing, go ahead. I'd much rather believe I'm going to have a mansion. My Bible says, "In my Father's house are many mansions." In the living Bible, it says, "In my Father's house are many rooms." I don't want a stinking room. I want a mansion. And my mansion, you know what color it's going to be? It's going to be scarlet and gray. Once a Buckeye, always a Buckeye. You're from Michigan? You better be sinking in your chair, son. You are in enemy territory. And we beat you the past 8 or 9 years. There you go. There you go. Let me see that hat. Let me see that hat. It fits. It fits. I know it. I know it. When I ride my bicycle down in Texas, I've got one of these bicycle shirts. It's got the three pockets in the back, you know, so you can put bananas and food and more water and stuff back there. You know? Because I'm going to ride 40, 50 miles. You need some stuff. You know what it says all over it? Ohio State. I've had more people try to kill me on the road in Texas. All right. There's the reality of the resurrection. There are the results of the resurrection. There are rewards of the resurrection. Now let me get to what our resolve should be, and I'll be done. The resolve. Look at verse 54. Let's back up. Verse 51. Let me read some verses here. Verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. This is the nursery verse, right? We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. It's a nursery verse. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. How do I know that? Because of the resurrection. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of law, sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because he rose from the dead. I know the Bible is the Word of God. How do I know it? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I know what it says is going to happen. How do I know it? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I know that when I die, I don't deserve it, but I know I'll go straight to heaven. Not because I'm a Baptist, not because I have degrees, not because I've written books, not because I do whatever, but because of Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ only. There's no way that I could ever be good enough to go to heaven. But now that I'm saved, I'm going to do those ordained works that he has for me to do, those good works that Ephesians tells us we are to walk in them, not to walk in sin. What should our resolve be? Realizing that there is a resurrection, and our preaching is not in vain, your faith is not in vain, you will see your lost loved ones. I get to see my daddy again. Died 13 or so years ago. I'll get to see him again and talk with him. I said recently that when I get to heaven, one of the first people I want to see is Eve. I want to have a talk with Eve. Eve. And I'm going to say, where's Adam? Come over here, boy. You know what kind of mess you caused? Yeah. I'm joking about that, of course, but I do want to talk to him. But my resolve, because of all that, I'll be 66 in October. And if I live to be 66, that'll be the oldest I will have ever been in my life. Okay? I'm not planning on retiring. I'm starting to feel the age. Starting to feel it. My brain, Brother Yoder, says, you can do that, but my body says, yeah, maybe 20 years ago. My brain says, you don't have to rest, but my body says, you better. You're with me. All of creation groans. We groan to be put clothed with that new body that's coming. So what should our resolve be? Look at verse number 58 and I'm done. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. Let's see, what did I teach in Sunday school? Oh, continue. Be faithful. I have had plenty of reasons to quit going to church. But I haven't. And I'm not going to. Be steadfast. Next time I come to Grove City, if Brother Slayball forgets about those early comments that I made, and he lets me come back here, unless you're dead, I expect to see you in these seats. How can you quit? I told my people when I pastored, what do you quit to? Because if you quit, you're going to go and do something else. If you quit church, you ain't going the right direction, son. What do you quit to? Besides that, I've always been afraid that if I quit today, tomorrow was going to be the day that God did something absolutely spectacular in my life. That keeps me going. I was within a signature. My signature, which is only 8 letters to my whole name. My signature. All I had to do was sign that contract. And Grace Baptist Church would not exist. I was that close. The man came to my house. He had the contract in his hand. He sat down, handed me the pen, and I looked at him and I said, I can't do this. Because God wanted me to start that church. And that church had already been in existence for about 8 years. It would have been gone. Wiped off the face of the earth. I cannot quit. And so therefore, I eat right most of the time. Take my vitamins, exercise, do everything I can to try to stay healthy. Try is the key word. I try. Because I want to live as long as I can so I can serve Him as long as I can. Look, if God Almighty loved me enough to send His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life, if He's willing to do that for me, then I can grow through some junk for Him. If He's willing to set His face like a flint and go to Jerusalem knowing that He's going to be crucified, knowing that He's going to actually physically die, I mean, the God of all creation was dead for 3 days. And He did that to pay for my sins and for yours. If He was willing to go through all of that, I can't even talk about quitting. And neither should you even think about it. I have a resolve. Because I don't serve a dead Savior, I serve a risen Savior. Go to see Him again. That's going to be fun. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable. Remember the verse this morning. It said, continue in the doctrine. You say, I don't like that doctrine. Continue in the doctrine. That's what God said. Amen. Unmovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. Hey, if you're a Sunday school teacher, be always abounding in the work of the Lord. It's not in vain. Everything is all right. Why? Because your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Why? Because He rose from the dead. He rose from the dead. Would you bow your heads, please? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Oh my, what a Savior we serve. We don't serve a statue. I've seen over in India, I saw them worshiping Confucius, and I saw them the Buddhists and the Muslims. I was in a church service in the far eastern part of India, and it was late at night, and I was super, super tired. I mean, I hadn't, you know, jet lag. You know, going over there, and I hit the ground running and preaching and going to different places, and I'm sitting there on a Sunday night, and the Christian, the preacher was preaching, and at the exact same time, you could hear all the Buddhists all around us, and they're worshiping another one of their many gods, which they do every single day. They're worshiping another one of their gods. And at the same time, at 7 o'clock that evening, you could hear the wail of the man up in the tower there, as the Muslims, as they were calling the men for the last prayer meeting for the night. All that sound was going on at the same time, and it was kind of spooky and kind of eerie. But I sat there and I said, man, I'm glad I serve a risen Savior. He rose from the dead, up from the grave He arose with a mighty triumph over His foes. I don't serve a Muhammad. I don't serve an Allah. I don't serve a Buddha. My God is not some guy sitting with his legs crossed, and he sit there, om, om. Om, om. That'd be kind of boring and all that. And I don't serve a Buddha and you know, where I go up and rub his belly and hope I get 7 years of good luck or whatever. Listen to me. We serve a risen Savior tonight. How can you want to live in sin? How can you want to do that? If you're not saved, how can you not get saved knowing that He rose from the dead? I love Him. I don't know about you, but I just love Him. I'm so thankful for Him. And when I mess up, I say, oh, God, I'm sorry. Disappointed you again. I'm sorry. I love you. We're going to give the invitation. I'm not going to tell you what to do. After I pray, you begin to play and sing. When they begin to play and sing, if you need to come pray about something, then you stand and come. Father, thank You for the day. Thank You for loving us. I pray now that Father will just keep this in mind and we'll have that resolve. I'm going to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as I know that my labor is not in vain. Lord, all these many months and years that I've traveled with, and my wife's in another complete different state, or that she's back home and separated from my family for anniversaries and birthdays, and but Father, it's going to be all worth it. It's going to be all worth it because we don't serve a dead Savior. We don't serve a dead God. We serve one who loves us and sent his Son and then proved him to be the Son of God by the resurrection of the dead. Father, just bless now the invitation, please. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go ahead and stand. They're singing and playing. You come. You come tonight.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live.
How about just coming to him and thanking him?
I surrender all.
How about just saying, thank you, Jesus, for dying for me on the cross. Thank you for being buried. Thank you for raising on the third day, just like the scriptures say. Thank you for it. Just thank him for it. Whatever you need tonight, take care of it tonight.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. Humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all. Oh, to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Oh, to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly thine. Feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, blessed Savior, I surrender all.
All right. Well, thank you very much for being patient with me. And, you know, he moved the microphone before the service, and it went like that. I said, man, that sounds like my bones in the morning. You know. I hope you pray for me. I mean, I'll be here for the night, and then in the morning get everything packed up and put my camper back together and head down the road, heading home for Texas, and, you know, pray for my safety and all that kind of thing. And but thank you for allowing me to come and be here, and I thank you very much for that, for the meal this afternoon in fellowship. Appreciate that. And Brother Mr. Yoder, it's good to see you again, and good to meet some new friends, too. All righty. And you come back when Brother Slayball's here, and don't wait too long now. You come back quick, okay? And if you're not a member of a church, then I suggest that you join this one. It's a good one. And I know Brother Slayball, so he's a good man. And but anyway, thank you for that. My books and candles are back there if you'd like to get one of them, or two or three or four. Again, anything that you give me over the price goes for that fuel fund that I have to help those new churches. And again, pray also that I get those 20 churches to support me for $50 a month. That's all I'm asking for. You know, a lot of missionaries, they need $10,000 to go to the country that they need to go to. I only need $1,000, and so pray we can get that worked up, okay? Well, God bless you, and turn it over to you, brother.
Amen. Let's sing our song of dismissal. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know.
It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in this army here below. It's a grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Amen. You are dismissed. Mark.